Chapter 12, 12 a.m. UTC minus 6, 7 a.m. UTC plus 1. Consciousness shifted from the front passenger seat of Jeremy's car to the front passenger seat of Tyler's car just after midnight on Sunday morning. One detail the same, I still felt the tension of the imminent Paris confrontation on Thursday. One detail different, Tyler's car was moving, directly toward a shredded tire lying on the highway. "Watch out!" I shouted. Tyler swerved, narrowly missing the debris. Tyler whistled. "Phew, that was close. Sorry, guys." I looked into the back seat. Jordan hadn't even stirred. Tyler and I laughed heartily at our sleep-loving friend. And with that laughter, I felt an equilibrium return. "Relax, Kyle," I told myself again. "You won't be any good to anyone if you're cranked up so tight." Oblivious to the reality I was living, Tyler picked a new topic. "So, Kyle, any girls on your mind these days? We've got to get you paired up, you know." I groaned, and Tyler laughed. I didn't speak easily about matters of the heart, and he knew that. Still, I could trust Tyler. This was not idle chatter. "I don't know, Ty. I guess I found myself thinking about someone from Bible school days. I talked with her a while when I was there recently." "When were you there? You haven't said anything about that." "Ouch, I haven't been there yet in chronological time." I mumbled a vague answer which Tyler didn't challenge. Instead, he asked, "What will you do about this girl?" "Beyond a plan to connect with her electronically, I don't know." There was no sense looking past Paris. I didn't know when or if my day skipping would stop, or if I would survive. "Okay, you may not know what to do," Tyler continued, "but how are you going to decide what to do? That might be the first step." I looked to see if Tyler had turned into a Swedish psychotherapist. Tyler turned the conversation to the matter of his long-distance relationship with his girlfriend. He used an example from that situation he thought might help me. As the time approached 1 a.m., Jordan woke up. I got ready for two day skips to take me past my sleeping self on Monday and into Tuesday. My hand moved forward in the motion of stuffing my carry-on bag into the overhead compartment on Lufthansa Flight 1026, Frankfurt to Paris. I finished the action. The hour in Montrouge was getting closer. Peace-giving God, steady me. I forced myself to attend to details in the aircraft environment. My ears detected smatterings of German, French, English, and at least four other languages. Soon all was ready and the plane began to taxi toward the assigned runway. It lifted off the ground at 7:20 a.m. local time. The seat next to me remained empty, so I didn't have to worry about talking with anyone. I looked out the window. I knew Germany, Luxembourg, Belgium, and finally France were rolling by underneath, although all was obscured, first by darkness, then by cloud as the hour passed. The alarm on my phone sounded persistently as I emerged from the day skip. I reached to the bedside table in my Hotel International room and canceled the alarm. Wednesday, January 7th, 7 a.m. in Paris, 12 midnight back home. The day of Charlie Hebdo. The plan for this day was to notify the authorities about the impending attack. But I knew I was being distracted by what faced me in my next hour, the Thursday attack in Montrouge, which I would try to prevent or change. The level of anxiety had risen sharply for me. I couldn't even keep my eyes focused in one spot. They roved restlessly, as did my mind. I'm in no condition to make an intelligent call to police. I want to be calm so I can make sense. I did some calculations. It's well over 4 hours until the Charlie Hebdo attack. If I wait until the 8 o'clock hour in this day, that will certainly still give them plenty of time to respond. I took a deep breath as I made that decision. Everything was getting so complicated, so life and death. So what will I do now, for the next hour? I felt the stubble on my face. I decided to physically get ready for the chronological day, and also inwardly prepare for what I was about to face in the south suburbs. So I rose, washed, showered, shaved, and dressed. I headed down to the ground level and helped myself to the breakfast bar. I'd rushed through my last two breakfasts, tomorrow's and the next day's, so I intentionally did not hurry. Took seconds. Prayed. Didn't pay attention to the time. The metro train decelerated into Alesia station on Thursday. The change in momentum caught me by surprise as I emerged from the day skip. My arms and legs shot out wildly from my sitting position. I groped for a handhold. A man across the aisle eyed me suspiciously. The train disgorged a sizable number of people. Only a few new passengers entered before the route resumed. The process repeated at Porte d'Orléans station. At 7:10 a.m., the terminus of Line 4 was reached, and I exited the train at the Mairie de Montrouge station. I paused before forcing anxious feet to ground level. Outside, a light drizzle continued. I zipped my jacket and flipped the hood over my head. The sky was still dark. I consulted the map application on my phone, matched the data on the display with what I saw in the real world, and set off northward along Avenue de la République. I waited at a nearby corner until I could cross an intersection of angled streets, then continued westward along Rue Gabriel Péri. A short ways on, I passed a car rental franchise. I recalled what Jeremy had told me, that the first time we would speak was by cell phone as I drove a rental car northeast of the city. The rental business was currently closed. Opens at 8 a.m., I noted. I continued westerly along the street. Taking the advice Jeremy would give me tomorrow, I looked for items to gather as potential weapons. Never thought I'd be doing this. To my surprise, I almost immediately spotted a 2-foot length of copper pipe on the side of the street. I picked it up. At 7:22, I came to a major road, Avenue Pierre Brossolette. The name sent a chill down my spine. I consulted my phone map and turned left. The drizzle ceased. At 7:27, I arrived at the intersection of Avenue Pierre Brossolette and Avenue de la Paix. I took a deep breath as I looked over the scene. Both sides of the street were tree-lined and fronted by buildings of various heights. A fenced lot occupied part of the street's opposite side. A few pedestrians dotted the sidewalks. Traffic was minimal. A street-sweeping vehicle idled not far away on the other side of the road, its operator trying to fix or adjust a part. I remembered another piece of Jeremy's advice: get close to whatever offered some protection. I moved toward a transit information display. I touched it and frowned. Pretty thin. Nothing that could stop a bullet. Westward, across Avenue de la Paix, grew a large tree. I went to examine it and immediately preferred its dense trunk as possible protection. Also near at hand sat some stout metal newspaper dispensers plus a line of parked vehicles. It wasn't much, but it would have to do. I noticed a solid fallen branch on the curb. I moved it closer to my spot behind the tree and lay the pipe beside it. A hint of light started to fill the cloudy sky. The time was 7:39. Most High, give me clear-mindedness and to be able to know what to do. I wished I knew more details about what would soon transpire. My heart pounded against my ribcage. I forced myself to breathe slowly and regularly. At 7:44, I looked to the left along Avenue Pierre Brossolette and saw what looked like a small vehicle with police car-style lights. But since it followed closely behind another vehicle, and because of the dim light, I couldn't be sure until it almost pulled even with my position. Emblazoned on the white hood of the car were the words Police Municipale. I started to move into the street with hand extended to gain the attention of the occupants. But exactly at that moment, to my right, there came a tremendous crash and noise of crumpling metal. I whirled to see. The police vehicle passed by. A short distance away, the car which was driving in front of the police vehicle had just been hit head-on by another car traveling in the opposite direction. The second car had veered into the wrong lane. The police car stopped near the collision. Two officers exited and started toward the crumpled vehicles. At the same moment, a black man with a shaven head emerged from the vehicle which had caused the crash and raised his arm. My gut clenched, and I opened my mouth to call out a warning, but the words never had a chance to escape my mouth. Two flashes accompanied two explosive cracks. One of the police officers collapsed. I heard my own voice shouting in disbelief. How had it happened so quickly? The next instant brought rage. Without thinking, I picked up the branch, shouted, "Koulibaly!" and threw it as hard as I could toward the assailant. A good throw. The branch twirled through the air and struck the man on the leg. He shouted in surprise. A moment later, he raised an object in my direction. I had just enough time to duck behind the tree trunk before several rounds spit from the weapon. The bullets smacked into the buildings and vehicles around me, one bit into the tree and sent wood fragments flying. I heard another voice from the direction of the crime, yelling. The sound of rushing footsteps, another spit of gunfire, a cry, a thud. A chill washed over me, the man operating the street sweeper, a civic employee. I recalled from a future news report that a civic employee had been injured in the incident. I felt sick. The assailant shouted defiantly, something about killing more heroes. There was a pause, and the same voice added, "Est-ce que devrait vous taire aussi?" I worked frantically to translate the words, and suddenly I knew. The other police officer, the terrorist, wanted to kill him too. Taking hold of the copper pipe, I cautiously looked around the tree trunk. The shooter was moving. Someone screamed as Koulibaly again raised the rifle. I stepped quickly into the open. Once again, I hurled my weapon. The pipe sliced past Koulibaly's head and clunked onto the vehicle behind him. I ducked behind a parked vehicle for cover. But no more shots were fired. There were more rushed footsteps and a frantic cry. I looked from behind the vehicle just in time to see Koulibaly pull a woman from a white hatchback car and throw her to the ground. The assailant jumped in and sped off eastward on Avenue Pierre Brossolette. The attack was over. I allowed myself to collapse, the horror of the situation washing over me. There came other voices as people ran to the scene. The fallen were being tended to, the authorities notified. I propped myself against a vehicle and reached for my phone in my jacket pocket. 7:55 a.m. A man came over, called me a hero, and asked if I was injured. I shook my head. Not injured. I'm also not a hero. The man went to help others. I sat there, heart pounding furiously, when the day skip came upon me. I sat in the front passenger seat of Jeremy's police car. "It must have just happened. Your expression changed," observed Agent Blanc. "What can you tell me?" I looked across to Jeremy, heart still thumping. I didn't save her. My voice cracked with emotion and I slumped over with head in hands. Jeremy was mercifully silent. I straightened. "What about the street sweeper, Jeremy? Was he shot too? I heard the gun and then a thump." Jeremy nodded. "Yes, he was shot when he intervened after Jean-Philippe went down. Badly hurt. The last I heard, he was stable but still in danger." More silence. I felt a hole in my psyche. "Have you been in situations where people have been killed when you couldn't stop it?" "Oui, Kyle. I have been with the police a long time and the army before that. I have seen too many things I wish I could have stopped." "How do you deal with it so you don't get PTSD? The acronym clearly meant nothing to Jeremy, so I clarified, "Post-traumatic stress disorder." Jeremy breathed in deeply. "Before I answer, let's go inside." I followed the Frenchman into the prefecture. We took the same route we had taken 10 hours/70 hours ago. Jeremy left me in the waiting area while he went to confer with his colleagues. A little while later he returned. "The Kouachis are still on the loose, not in the city it seems, but we feel we are closing on them. Koulibaly, whereabouts unknown." He motioned for me to follow, and we went to a cafeteria-style lunchroom. Several other police agents and prefecture staff sat in scattered positions. Jeremy took a bagel, and we each selected a coffee. "French coffee usually comes in small portions and strong," Jeremy noted conversationally. "But I prefer mine un café américain, like you serve it in North America. A little weaker, but more of it." As soon as he had said those words, he abruptly straightened and looked at me with a strange expression on his face. But he dismissed whatever notion had struck him, and we proceeded to an empty table. We sat across from each other. Jeremy asked me to tell him in my own words what took place in Montrouge. I did. Then Jeremy got to the point. "Here is what I have learned, Kyle, about dealing with these things. I do not bury the thoughts and feelings that come about bad situations I see. But I do not tell my wife, I do not tell my son. I tell someone who will not be traumatized by what they hear. For me, that is a buddy in the Police Nationale. For you, that is me." Fortunately for me, paying attention to my inner state was not a strange exercise. So I thought for a moment, then started, "I feel like a failure. anger, frustration. I didn't know enough about what had happened and assumed it would be obvious what I could do to stop the killing of that officer. My head sank. Jeremy let those words settle for a few moments. Then, "You feel like you failed, like you did not accomplish the important thing you wanted." Understandable. You acted on a noble impulse which did not come through into reality. So, the next question to answer, is your well-being connected to the fact you failed, or that you tried? I considered this, but before I could comment, Jeremy continued, "But now I will stop playing the counselor and play the policeman once again. You did not wholly fail. You saved one person in the incident." I reflected. "The second officer?" I ventured. Jeremy nodded. "Those present at the scene reported Koulibaly was going for the second officer, probably to kill him too. Some eyewitnesses said that an unknown man threw something which distracted Koulibaly. That unknown man was you, was it not? You scared the gunman before he could get to the officer. Kyle, you saved that man." I felt my soul lift a little. A question came to me. Did I give a statement to you or another police officer about what had happened there? Jeremy shook his head. No, our information came from others at the scene. You were not there when police arrived, and you did not provide these details to me when we spoke yesterday. I left the scene before police arrived? Jeremy continued. Normally I would say you must stay at the scene of the crime to give your statement, but I know you did not. And I know that it is imperative you start toward the service station northeast of the city which the Kuwashis will rob. You gain information there which we must have. What information? Koulibaly's phone number. I was stunned. And just how will I get that from armed terrorists? Jeremy shrugged. I don't know. You never told me. But I know you got it, or will get it. Jeremy went to a different topic. What about Wednesday? Have you tried to notify authorities about the Charlie Hebdo attack? No, but I will do it in the next hour I experience on that day. Jeremy sighed. I wonder why that tip was never treated seriously. We both watched the time advance the last few minutes before the start of the next hour. The day skip enfolded me.